Frodo?
What, Sam?
What's the answer to this question?
Oh, Sam, I can't help you.
What is it a transonique anyway? It's nothing unnatural, is it?
Shh.
Gentlemen, might I remind you that there be no cheating on this final exam.
Or you shall not pass!
Good morning, students. Welcome to school. Remember, the thought of the day is
conspiracy theory stuff that, you know, I think that it brings up life with conversation.
Welcome to Ecology 101, the story of the nerd and geek and their natural habitat. I'm Gary, and today I have a special guest. Who are you, man? It's my brother.
John,
my brother John. Yeah, this is number two in the lineup of the Fabulous Six. So there you go. And I'd be number four in that number system there, too. So, and Ron is five, and
yeah,
there you go.
Yeah,
number two. Number two. There you go.
I don't need someone telling me that.
Oh my gosh, it's it. Yes. Oh my gosh. Thanks for not being number one. And today is so funny because we often talk about we have a humorous family, which obviously you guessed from some of us, but it's a thread. And John, I want to talk about John because, well, we love our brother John, and he's a big sci-fi fan. And we were talking about some great shows out there that I'm trying to think if we've hit or not. Probably not, because there's so many of them. But you had mentioned, now I haven't seen Babylon 5, but I've heard about it. So great show. What do you love about that show?
Well, I mean, you know, you have kind of like the Deep Space Nine, that you had a variety of different civilizations, you know, the different
right.
people that were there. But it was always a good storyline.
It's easy to find something worth dying for. Do you have anything worth living for?
Yes.
And
no!
It went on for, I think, 5-6 years.
Oh, yeah.
And like I said earlier, what always, I guess, interests me is why didn't they have action figures? Why didn't they have...
Oh, yeah, that's what you're saying.
They're not in reruns. You can't find them anyplace.
So oh.
What happened? Who has the rights that they don't want to share with everybody?
Yeah.
I thought it was an outstanding program.
Sci-Fi Channel, right? Was it on Sci-Fi Channel, I think?
No, it was... this was pre-Sci-Fi Channel, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay.
Yeah, it was... I want to say almost 10 years ago, probably longer.
Right. Yeah, and, you know, they brought Battlestar Galactica back, you know, but would Babylon 5 coming back be the same? Would they ruin it? Is it something you don't mess, like Chitty Chitty Bang Bang? I don't know.
I don't know. I mean, there were so many diverse characters. I don't know how, you know, you could introduce anything you want. I mean, you know, it's the basic story.
Right.
I got to tell you, is Ron on?
No, he's not on today, but you can go ahead. He'll hear it.
The woman that plays one of the pilots in Battlestar Galactica.
Oh.
You know what?
No, but you know what? There's a character. Oh, who did she say mentioned?
She was also on.
She pop up on The Mandalorian?
Longmire.
Oh, Longmire. Oh, is it the. Oh.
You know who I'm talking about?
Is it the main character? The lady? Because she's played.
Well, it's one of the women on the police force, or the only woman.
Oh.
Anyway, Ron and I went to that alien con, the first one.
Right.
Just a nice woman. I think, you know, Ron had a little crush on her.
Right. Oh, you know what? She's the one that played, didn't she and Ant-Man play the one that laid the girl that faced? Was that her?
I'm not sure.
I thought it was.
I can't remember what her name
You caught me because I'm on the internet right now. I have to look it up.
just a nice person and you know.
Right.
Good looking woman. Ron was kept every time we saw her, he'd have to go up and
Hello there. So, okay.
And it's always nice when you see these people out in public that are, I remember we were in line for Starbucks when we first saw her.
Right.
And there was a disabled vet in a wheelchair that she just spent as much time as possible.
Oh.
Why we're getting up to the front of the line.
Do you know her character's name? I pulled it up here. Katie, by chance? Or Katie, there's Katie Lautmeier and there's another.
No. It was one of the.
Police officers?
Yeah.
Okay. We'll have to investigate. There you go. Ron will know. He'll tell us, it was that you. Oh, you yeah, yeah.
So. And I tell you that Alien Con was a lot of fun.
Oh, it sounds like fun. We're coming back hopefully after COVID.
That was the first one. They had sold 4,000 tickets.
Oh, yeah.
12,000 people.
Sure, that's how it works. Oh, yeah.
So, of course, they had different conference rooms for different topics.
Karen right. Gillan shaves her head.
Isn't Nebula bald?
I've seen you for 400 and wow. There's 1,000 trying to get in.
Oh, sure.
So, you know, it was logistically, it was absurd.
Oh,
it
was just, first
some
one.
Some of the topics that they had, some of the people that they had, it was a lot of fun.
Sounds good. And that's been going on for a while now, right? The Alien Con?
Well, yeah. And
they get better.
They have them all over the United States now.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
But we were at the first one.
Right. Oh, no, that's it. It's like saying I went to the first. You know, Comic-Con or something. But, hey, we'll see with COVID how all that comes together too, right? It's like, man, it's going to be a while.
Don't even get me going.
The other show you were talking about too, and I got into, I think my son got me into, was The Expanse, which I do have a couple pieces coming out about that. But, James Holden, that's the captain then. They call him the Modern Day Knight or something. But, yeah, it's a great show. It really is really interesting.
Well, what's good is, you know, it's all, you know.
It could
Mars
be.
Versus the, you know.
Yeah, Mars versus but the Belters.
My phone's dying, so I got to go get my charger.
Got it. No problem.
Yeah, I really enjoyed the Expanse. The problem is when you get into season 3 is when you start, you know, you got to go back. And,
oh, sure. Is that when they've already did the warp gate thing? They've already discovered by that point, huh?
Yeah, you know, I haven't seen it. I know that I think what? It's on either Netflix or...
Wait, you jumped into Series 3? You jumped right into Series 3? You didn't go back to the beginning?
When I first started watching it, it was already second or third season.
Oh,
so
it's on Netflix. Yeah. Oh, it's on is it on Amazon? I think it's on Amazon Prime.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I enjoyed that one.
Oh, yeah. You gotta go back and watch the whole thing.
There's a couple good. Really good ones on.
Yeah. Are you talking about Netflix? Yeah.
I kind of think what we're going through with this COVID-19 may be another sci-fi thing that we don't even know about.
Oh, I'm sure there's a lot being produced right now that, yeah, we don't know. Yeah.
I think the whole society is caught up in some sci-fi.
Sure. Well, you know what's funny is, you know what they said that really has become... they can work on and people worked on home was animated stuff. And one of the ones that I started watching, I told my guys about it. They're like, was on CBS All Access. It's the guys that did Rick and Morty. They did, it's called The Lower Decks. And it's basically, it's an animated Star Trek one, but it's funny because it pokes fun at Star Trek, but it knows it's Star Trek.
What else did we do? I just wanted to say I was wrong. I'm glad we followed our guts today. You are my mentor.
Whatever, nerd. Come on, we can hang without me being your mentor.
I thought you wanted that.
Yeah, my target kind of moves.
Well, from now on, no more being obsessed with rank. Time to start appreciating what I have right here.
Hey, you know what? I like this new Boimler.
Good work today, Boimler. Ransom says you're one of his best.
Thank you, Captain Riker, sir!
Hey, how about you buy me a drink? You know, since we're even, remember something with the aliens...
And it's funny, just all the inside jokes and stuff, but it's an interesting show, and it's goofy humor. You know, it's Rick and Morty humor. But it's on there, and I don't know. I thought it was – it even had Riker on there, too, at the end. Just kind of – the way he does his warp is so fun.
Have you seen this Snowpiercer? It's on, like
– I've seen the movie. I've seen the movie with oh, my gosh. Who am I thinking of? Captain America. Oh, boy, this is terrible. You're catching me first thing in the morning.
What this is about is a futuristic thing.
Mm-hmm. The train.
Middle of a new ice age.
Right.
So they have a train.
Mm-hmm.
think each, they say like 10 cars or whatever, and I think they're like a mile long or whatever.
Yes.
And they...
Society.
You know, they capture the cream of society was supposed to be on this train.
Yes.
And so, anyway, it's interesting.
You should watch the movie, because there's a movie for it, Snowpiercer, and it's really different, and I'm sure the show is sort of like the... Do you remember... what am I thinking of? Logan's Run. Remember, it was the movie, and then they did the TV show and expanded it? That's pretty much what they did. So they took this... So Snowpiercer, yeah, it's really different. The whole movie's really different.
You know, the one movie that I don't understand why they haven't done a remake on is Soylent Green.
Oh, wow. It's made from people.
I don't remember Soylent Green.
Oh, they could.
I was a teenager.
Wow.
That's how old it is.
Yeah.
And it is in color, by the way.
Oh, yeah, because you got to see the green. Yeah, Soylent Red, Soylent Green, Soylent Yellow.
Well, you know, I don't know if you know what this story is about. It's a futuristic stuff.
Remind
you know,
us.
Caesar, yeah. Are dead. You know, there's, you know, you can't get the food supply is provided by the government and it's wafer chips.
Yes, right.
And this is
Charlton Heston, yeah. Mm-hmm. He's a police officer, right?
But why they haven't redone that? You know, you look at everything that's going on global warming and this and that. I mean, they could really do a good job on it.
Well, maybe people have taken, you know how they take the theme of it and they kind of just maybe branched off in something else. I do remember that scene because he says, I remember he lived in like real squalor, but it was like average stuff, like on a porch. And then the rich people had plastic furniture, and then he found this piece of celery is all wilted. He goes, "That's beautiful. What is that?" It's just
where they had the thing of jam, and they were like putting their finger in to get the last bit of jam out.
Right. Know? Yes. It does say, you know, it does say a lot about, wow, yeah, you're right. Maybe, hey, you never know. Maybe someone will pick this up and go, yeah, it's pretty good. It's a topic. It's a tough one with, you know, everyone. Yeah, a lot of, what do you call it? A lot of...
So here's my plot for a science fiction.
All right. Right? You got good ideas, so here you go.
All this COVID is all an alien substance that they have.
Ooh.
That it's really not killing. It's like a bad flu, mm-hmm. right? And the idea is everyone gets the...
vaccination?
You know, they get the vaccination, and what's in the vaccination, it's going to change humankind.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Right?
Yeah.
Doesn't that sound like...
Ooh, too close to truth.
Who knows? Who are getting money from the, you know, because, of course, you know, the aliens are among us.
Right, right.
We talk about this at work, and of course.
And tell us where you work at, by the way, too, John. You're up in Sacramento, right? You're up in Sacramento, so you're kind of you're in Sacramento where you work at.
Yeah, it's not that we, secret. You know, we hear a lot of stuff that makes you wonder.
Take your notes.
You know?
Right?
I wonder why our governor, you never find him with a mask.
Oh.
Around his neck.
Oh.
Yep. You look around the country, you look at all of the people who should know what's going on.
Sure.
You know, governors, congressmen, they don't seem to take it as serious as they're telling us to take it.
Yeah. There's a lot going on. There's a lot going on.
So, I mean, I just, you know, I like the conspiracy theory stuff that, you know, I think that it brings up lively conversation.
Sure. And there's a way to do it. Is it crazy? Right. Yeah.
Some people just—they don't want to hear anything because it bothers them. I said, well, you know, they told us the first people who are going to die are homeless, and we even had a memo for state employees. At least that's where I got it. That what to do if you find somebody laying on the sidewalk.
Oh.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So it kind of gets that doom and gloom that people are just going to just fall down and die.
Sure. Right.
Well, then I said, well, you know, half the homeless are aliens, right? They're just here spotting everything out.
Spotting everything out, right.
And said, you know how you tell that they're aliens? When they blink, their eyes don't go north to south. They go east to
west. Oh, just like on Men in Black. There you go. Yeah, gotcha. He blinked twice. What do you mean blink twice?
And, you know, some people get really offended, and other people sit and laugh, and we talk about it.
You got to keep your sense of humor. You got to keep your sense of humor. Oh, well, my gosh. Yeah.
Well, and the big thing is with this COVID, you know, what's being printed is not necessarily what we're being told.
Sure.
And I talk to administrators all the time, and they're saying, hey, I don't know. In fact, one down in your area, your
right.
neck of the woods.
Sure.
Talking to administrators that the administrator was talking to somebody in the press out in out on the other part of the county from you guys,
right,
off of Highway 10 that give you the region, and the woman says she's the administration person.
Mm-hmm.
She goes, he was saying, oh, well, we're below 15%, and she goes, we don't even have 15%.
Mr. Chambers, don't get on that ship. The rest of the book, To Serve Men, it's a cookbook.
She's getting upset because what is he doing telling a falsehood on
sure.
capacity in the ICUs?
Yeah.
I'm hearing that all of these are projected amounts.
Ah, gotcha.
We project we're going to be under 15%.
Sure.
Well, they've been projecting this stuff from the very beginning, and I don't know what model they're using, but it's not that accurate.
Yeah.
So instead of shutting down everything because of a projection, why don't you allow it to, you know?
Sure. There's a lot of good little common sense things to. Yeah, and you know what? And the thing is,
it'd make a great science fiction.
I would say, yeah, because it does sound, yeah, it's like, and you know, a lot of these movies have elements of things like, hey, wait a minute, they're telling us this or that. So, you know, it's just, kind of like sci-fi has always been like very predictive. And it's like, wow, it's kind of crazy how close to life it is, too. And you know,
it's like all these things, everything from all these movies from the 50s and forward, they're all coming.
Just warning you. Yeah.
Of how we're approaching the coronavirus.
Right. You know,
think about it. If there was something in that virus that would change mankind.
Right. Yeah.
We're all gonna line up and give me the shot. Give me
right. The shot. Well, yeah. Well, we'll see. I'm like, I like who I am. But you know what's funny is, here's Wag the Dog, where it kind of reverses. And I'm watching sometimes going, hey, like in real life, I'm like, wait, that's the plot to The Empire. You know, like what Palpatine did. You know, like cause a problem and then come in and fix it. You know what I mean? I'm like, wait a minute. We got people doing that kind of stuff too.
You know, but if you study history,
yeah,
there's a lot of that happens.
Yes.
We create something in order for us to cure something.
Right. There's a lot of that going on.
You know?
Oh, yeah.
If you remember the Spanish-American War, who's the guy who Hearst? Hearst said, you know, you want a war, I'll create a war. So he was the one who ran with the story that the Maine blew up.
Right.
You know, that it was...
Sure.
That it was Spanish that did it, which now we find out that was not the case.
Ah, there you go.
But, you know...
New cells, yeah.
If Vremek discovered that the data rod was a forgery, if he realized that we were trying to trick them into the war, it could push the Romulans even farther into the enemy camp. They could start to openly help the Dominion. If worse came to worst, they could actually join the war against us. I had the distinct feeling that victory or defeat would be decided in the next few minutes.
It's a fake!
And it's so real!
It's a fake!
It's crazy.
It's real!
Yeah, and you know, that there's always been things that have happened, and you say, that doesn't seem right. Well,
sure.
There's a reason why that doesn't seem right, because it isn't right.
Right, right. Are you... You said you watched Deep Space Nine, right? You ever seen the whole thing?
Yeah.
Okay, so remember...
Well, I remember when it was on, you know, weekly, so...
Yeah.
I remember watching those until he took
it out. In the middle of their Dominion War, they had a plot... They wanted to get the Romulans involved because they needed the help, and so they staged a fake news, pretty much, right? To get them to think that something's happening, and it got uncovered, and they had to, Garrick had to someone, so they, and the what, and Sisko says, I can live with this. And it's like it was one of those, you know, secretive things that kind of turn the tide of the war. It's like, whoa. And there's some, yeah. No, it's kind of tough when things, good people have to make those weird decisions. You know, it's like, wow, crazy.
You know, my favorite character on that was the Ferengi, you know?
Oh, yeah, Quark.
With earlobes.
Yes, oh, so funny. Yeah, Armin Zimmerman, he's a great character.
What was interesting there is they could introduce new cultures, new races.
Oh, yeah.
On a weekly basis if they wanted to.
We learned a lot about the Klingons in that one. Yeah.
Some reason, oh. I didn't think that the characters they just didn't seem, you know, plausible.
Did you finish the whole series?
What's that?
Did you finish the series?
I watched it when it was on TV. I don't know if I.
Oh, did, you know? I don't know. I thought they developed pretty good, so it was more of a.
And the one that I thought was really good is the one with Scott Bakula.
Oh yeah, Enterprise. Yeah, it's good. It ended too soon. Yes. Yeah, it was good. Yeah, and what's funny is these newer shows are tying in a lot, like Picard and Discovery. They're tying all that stuff back in, so you kind of get all these little pieces. Like, wow, that's pretty good. So, very interesting.
So that book that I sent you.
Oh yes,
You enjoyed that?
I did. Yeah. So the book that John is talking about is it's Picard, and it's basically. So they have the TV show that kind of you see the aftermath and where Picard is. This is what built up to it. It was good. It was really interesting. It really gave you a lot of the backstory and what happened. And Remy? His the lady he worked with and how they built their... Yeah, and then why... Uh-oh. Is my computer sleeping? And why they... why, you know, everyone felt like he turned his back on him. It was a tough... That was a really tough... turn, and they even Geordi, they talk about all the people that were tied into all that stuff, and it was good to kind of tell you what exactly happened. They didn't tell you who did it, that's for the show, but they did tell you, you know, the background, and and I really got to know the characters a lot better too, so it was good.
You know, what's interesting is you go back and you watch some of these old black and whites from the 50s and early 60s. I think that for early science fiction, those are some of the, you know, the golden age of,
oh, right,
if you want, the first round.
Sure.
A lot of them made you really think that, I think that we got some stuff in the 70s and early 80s that you really didn't have to think watching it, you know. You watched it, it was entertainment, but
right,
there was no thought process after.
Sure, sure.
So,
do you think it's changing now? They're bringing more of those, hey, make you think, like, oh, interesting, right?
Yeah.
Have you been watching Discovery? Have you gotten to that yet?
I have.
Are you in season 3?
I think I'm a season behind because it's on, is it ABC or whatever?
CBS All Access, yeah.
It comes on Thursday, so yeah, I've been watching that.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Yeah, so it's some good storytelling, and we know we tend to look at the characters and things they go through, and there's a lot of good ones too, so.
Well, you know, what I find interesting is more and more they're having female leads,
mm-hmm.
you know, in the programs, which I think is interesting.
Yeah.
Growing up, of course, there's six of us, and five boys and one girl, and Belinda being the youngest.
She got outnumbered.
Before, you know, anything. So growing up, if you don't grow up around women other than your mother, you have a different
sure.
outlook on women.
Sure, right.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
You know, and growing up, it was pre-Title IX, so, you know, you do sports, but there weren't female sports other than volleyball. And
that's definitely changed, yeah.
So, you know, it was kind of a different era in, you know, seeing, not saying that you didn't see women as equal, you just saw them as different.
Sure.
And the fact that, well, maybe there's not an opportunity for them to do this, but you don't think, oh, well, that's really bad. You just think, well, you know, that's sad. But when you start having daughters, you're saying they're as capable as anybody else.
Your whole perspective changes.
They have the opportunities.
Right. Yep. Yeah, exactly.
So,
that is interesting, huh?
You know,
Oh, and yeah. Oh, yeah. There's pretty much whatever you want to do, and that's I think that's a good. Well, you know, and she did. What's funny is it's how your perspective on both sides changes. Like, I talked to guys about how my daughter. I have a whole different perspective on what dance is. It's a lot of work. It's a sport, and you appreciate it more. And she's got me into, you know, I did the thing and got her all involved in nerd stuff and outdoors. And then, of course, the guys give me a hard time, but, you know, she got me into watching all the old musicals, you know, and you learn to appreciate a lot of things. So there's a give and take there. And, you know, but yeah, pretty much.
Well, you know, there's some great stories.
Oh, they are stories. Yeah.
I mean, you know, it's good entertainment.
It's good. Yes. And, you know, it's give and take. So you turn yourself around, and that's what it's all about.
Yeah.
Yes.
I put my right hand in when I should have been turning around.
Ah, gotcha. So you have to have some rhythm. That would help, right?
Maybe, maybe that.
Maybe you were like Steve Martin, right? Didn't he have no rhythm after one? Until you heard the jerk, right? Well, do you remember when he was Navin Johnson, though? He didn't have any beat, and then hear the music. Dun, 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 dun. I got it. I got the beat. So funny. Oh, things are going to start happening to me now. Yeah, no, that's good. There's a lot. Yeah, I said there's a lot of good. You know what's great is we cover, like, pretty much anything in the sci-fi, fantasy, whatever, and nothing's off. So there's a lot of fun things. I'll tell you, one of the ones they reviewed recently, but I haven't got into it, is called The Boys. Have you heard of that one? It's kind of a dark, intense superhero one, but you know, there's a big spectrum of things out there, you know. But
have you seen I see advertisements for The Watch.
The Watch. No, BBC's got a lot of good shows though with that too. No, I haven't seen it.
You know, I tell you, when I was in the military, I went to a movie convention, and of all places, what is it? Cologne in Germany.
Right.
And the sci-fi stuff that the Germans were putting out, I mean, I couldn't understand what they were saying.
Sure.
But just the, you know, just the backdrop and you know, special effects. And this is, remember, mm-hmm. this is probably early 80s.
Wow.
It was fantastic.
Wow, there you go.
It was like, wow.
Wow.
You know, and yeah. I was saying, Can somebody translate this stuff for me? But they were really outstanding.
Interesting. Very, very good. Well, you checked out that series, The Three Body Problem, right? The one that did you get a chance to read that yet or not?
I haven't finished it.
Oh, okay. But it's different because that's from China, Chinese sci-fi. It's different, but it ties in a lot of, like, they it's almost like in some ways reminds you of, who am I thinking of? This is horrible. Jurassic Park. Why am I drawing his name? Not Grisham. Who am I thinking of? Come on. wow. Well, I'm terrible. Jurassic Park, the author, right?
I couldn't.
Hold on. Oh, this is terrible. I'm doing it off the top of my head with no notes here. But it's the same author, and I should have that book here handy, and I don't. But I'm sure someone's yelling and not going, "You dummy!" but they're very detailed. They like the detail and fact, so it could actually feel like it happened, you know. And
there was a sci-fi book that I read a couple of years ago by a Russian author, and it takes place in
Michael Crichton.
I think the book is 1033 or something to that effect. It's a date. And everything takes place in the underground metro in Moscow.
Oh, wow.
And the currency is a bullet.
Oh, wow.
They use currency. They'll trade the 45 caliber rounds.
Interesting.
That's currency. And it's every station or every platform that they have in the underground becomes a city.
Oh, wow. Oh, wow. Oh, interesting.
It's pretty different.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of great sci-fi out there.
Yes.
There's an author that I think is on his fourth book now. I think it's Michael Gear. Mm-hmm. Michael W. Gear or W. Michael Gear something. Last name is Gear. And he has this planet that you know, humans have gone to colonize, and everything on the planet can kill you.
Sounds like Skull Island. That's like King Kong.
You know, they've got trees that if you stand underneath them, that the roots will come up and grab you.
Oh, wow.
And, you
know, interesting. That's a fight for survival.
You know, and they call the planet Donovan because the first person that died was named Donovan.
Oh, my gosh.
So, wow. You know, it's just interesting because every book a new cargo ship comes.
Mm-hmm.
And something happens to them because, you know, that the last one, the people that were on it to survive, they all were woken up early from their stasis, became cannibals.
Oh, no. Wow. Gotcha.
So, you know, so this, every book is different, and it's, I find it very interesting.
Interesting.
So if you get tapped, I think the name is W. Michael Gear. The last name is Gear.
Gotcha. Hey, yeah. You know what? Real quick, I have to start doing this, but I'm going to take... We started doing commercials, so I'm going to take a pause right here for a commercial break.
This is flight number 914 from Earth to our planet. We will be taking off in 3 minutes.
Gary?
Yeah.
Why am I sitting in a hot tub? And holding bowls of cereal?
Well, just an idea I had for a commercial for my upcoming book, Chronolosity Fistful of Chronotons.
Okay, explain.
Well, my main character, Levy, invents a water-based time machine and is in a race against time to save his family, hence the hot tub.
So it's just the hot tub time
machine? It's not the hot tub time machine.
All right. Hot tub makes sense, I guess. But what's up with the cereal?
Well, when I was writing the book, you guys kept saying crotons sound like a breakfast cereal.
It does, actually. That's true.
So we're eating bowls full of crotons in the hot tub with two.
That's the power of podcasting, Gary. Nobody can tell we're sitting in a hot tub eating a bowl of cereal.
All right. So let's dry up and think of a decent commercial for Gary's book.
Right.
Hey, don't know if you're out there writing a book or have an idea for a book, but I tell you what, one of the things I found out with putting together books I've been working on, of course, my friend John Pepe, that an editor is huge. It's like having a co-author, actually, someone to really invest in your work and really gets you, ask you those tough questions and really get your work ready for, well, maybe you're self-publishing or going to a traditional publisher. Check out By the Hand Editing. Angie Martin, you've heard her on our show. She's actually one of our hosts now. Has that online, which you can find on Facebook. Great. We've really enjoyed getting to use their service. And I tell you what, we're going to keep coming back because they have really, they're great people. They do a great service and it's a great price. So I would encourage you, if you haven't got a chance to check them out, By the Hand Editing, that's Angie Martin. And they have some fantastic deals and prices for you. They'll work with you and be able to help you get that book ready for wherever your journey takes you. So thank you so much for checking them out and tell them Nikology sent you.
You still on Earth or on the ship with me? Well, it doesn't make very much difference because sooner or later, we'll all of us be on the menu.
And we're back. So when we cut this, we know because we started doing commercials for book stuff too. So there you go. Well, Gary, we'll give our first break, commercial break. Michael Crichton. That's who I was talking about.
Oh yeah.
And his is when you read the book Jurassic Park, he basically shows you like, hey, this could really happen. Like the science behind it. That's what the three body problem reminds you of, because they give you like the science behind it. You're like, whoa. Like the practicality of it. And you're just like, well, this is like, you know, science realism or something like that. I don't know. So,
well, you know, when my kids were all young, I always made sure that they got a book for Christmas.
Oh, yeah. That was awesome.
And, you know, and I never really cared what they read as long as they read something.
Right.
And, you know, and each of the kids have favorite books that they enjoy reading.
Sure.
And some that they can't stand. I don't know anybody. None of my kids could ever get through Moby Dick.
And, those are thick reads. Those are tough reads.
And Victoria told me that Wuthering Heights, she hated
that. Yeah.
I've never read it.
Red Badge of Courage, I couldn't get past the first page. There's a certain one.
Oh, Red Badge of Courage. Paul's probably read that about 10 times.
Oh, my gosh. Well, see, it's a different books connect with their people. Which one of your kids loved, and you're the one that got me hooked on, and I think it was your grandson, but John Carter. Because you kept talking about it, and I read them like, this is good. Wow.
You don't have to have those books that have.
Yep.
So I got it and I started reading it and I said, this is great. And I gave it to one of my grandsons and they read it and it's just been passed around.
Right.
But think about that, that was written, you know, in what, 1900?
Over 100 years ago, yeah. Yep.
Yeah. And for a split second, I said, well, how could they know all this stuff?
Right.
Well, you know.
They had everything cloning, they had hovering cars, they had. What they call it, the ninth
time
ray,
travel.
Time travel, yeah, all kinds of stuff, everything, yep.
And you know how back at that time there wasn't bookstores, so what you do is you would hire someone as an agent to go around and sell your book.
Right.
So they would go to affluent people in your town.
Wow.
And get them to buy a book.
That's right, thy book agent. Wow, interesting.
Yeah. Or they would run them in a magazine. Chapter of a weekly or a monthly magazine, and reading how that whole process of selling your literature was done, I thought that was kind of interesting.
Sure. I know C.S. Lewis, they did a lot of things, serial things, or they would send in things to paper. They would do things in little pieces, right? But it's changed a lot.
So I enjoy John Carter.
Yes. John Carter.
I couldn't get into Tarzan. I don't know why.
Huh.
I just
same author, different. Yeah. So.
Yeah.
And I just read, this is a funny, I just finished Thundar. Do you remember the cartoon, right? Thundar the Barbarian. So the original book is nothing like the thing, but it's very much, some people say, yeah, it's a lot like John Carter in some ways, but it's on Earth and it jumps into a future Earth and it's got, it's interesting. And obviously it's the first book. But it's good, but yeah, it's very John Carter-like in a lot of ways, too, so very popular.
You know, I was hoping that, with all the grandkids I had, that I'm glad that none of my daughters or daughter-in-law had to have a C-section, but I was hoping...
Oh, gosh, I know where this is going.
Going
at the cesarean. Yep. See, I told you we have the humor. I'm just telling you. So there you go.
Somehow my kids just don't.
I know. Yep.
Don't appreciate my humor.
Right. Well, I had a friend, and of course, I probably could listen to the show, but last name was Shockey, and they're looking for a name for their daughter. I'm like, well, you know the perfect name, right? Electra. It's perfect. Why wouldn't you not want that one, right? So, Electra Shockey. Anyway. But yeah, we try. Da-da-da. But yes. Of course, you gotta live with names like Rip Torn, right? So, poor kid.
So, I got this letter from a hospital administrator.
Right.
Her name is Patience P. McGee.
Oh my God! Wow! That's awesome. Oh my gosh! You know what? Some names they fit. You know, I'll tell you what. Groku. Is Groku still working on me though?
I'd always be concerned that, you know, you're going to stick a child with a name that's going to destroy them, you know.
Right, right. Well, on that note, so funny, because I have, they got me last Christmas. I got he's looking right at me, this, Baby Yoda, now child, or Grogu. I'm still, but I mean, I'm glad they didn't call him, like, you know, Yoda whatever. It's like, yeah, you got to mix it up a little bit. So names, that name sometimes sticks with somebody too. So, you know, you try. That's all you could do. But so that's good. Yeah, a lot of good sci-fi. There's this. I'm actually watching Rebels right now. They got me in the animated stuff, which is good. It's very interesting. It gives you all the Star Wars backstory. But a lot of. And then my son just showed me all the Star Wars movies and shows coming out. They got a Lando one. They have the Rogue Squadron. All kinds of stuff. It's like, holy cow, they're gonna nail us.
You know, Disney. Disney's really going to pump a lot of money.
They've been stockpiling.
Let's hope that they get some quality.
Well, at this time right now, Disneyland's closed.
I mean, they're making tons of money off that.
Yeah, it did great. And sometimes just one. Yeah, as long as you don't overdo it. You know what I mean? Like, saturate it. I mean, because, you know, realistically, we have lives. You can't sit and watch TV all, because that's pretty much what you do to catch up all these shows. I'm like, got to pick and choose. It's hard.
Oh, you know, you watch them on your phone while you're driving to work.
And that's where the I know. That's a sci-fi show right there, right? Oh, did you see? Do you know what we saw recently? It was the last week. This is a major sci-fi play. We saw the last. It's called Dark. Is it called Dark Fate? It was the last Terminator one. And which is actually good because Linda, the original lady, was in that, right? And but what's funny is I think the episode before that, they were all talking about, you know, the Skynet, but they changed the name of it because they changed the future. But everyone, they jump into like the 90s and everyone's on their cell phones and like, and iPads are like, it's already starting. You know, the machines are already getting them. I'm like, yeah, pretty much.
Well, so. you think about it. So we got the state's trying to push this phone app that will tell you when you've been in contact with someone.
Oh, that just COVID popped up last night. I just saw that.
For more than 5 minutes. And I'm saying, how in the world does this work? Mm-hmm. The only way it would work is if you would have to report it, or anyone who got COVID would have to have their phone number.
Right.
Into this program. I don't know how it works, but, yeah. You know, our director said, well, you know, we highly encourage. And I said, hell no, I ain't going to do it.
I got it. Yeah. Dave, or it's John.
I know where I'm at.
Yeah, it's like Hal, right? Okay, John, this is time to put your app. No.
Well, you know, I got really upset with the fact that a couple months ago I stopped at a corner and my phone says, "How was your trip to Taco Bell?" I said,
"Oh,
there's a Taco Bell right down the street. You know, I can see it. Well, how do you know where I'm at?"
Oh, yep.
You know, I you know, not that I'm doing anything wrong, but the government doesn't need anything from me.
Well,
you know?
Right, we're not that special, and you know they don't need to know everything about our lives. It's like,
Well, they already know everything that they need to know.
Yes. Did you change your underwear today?
Your audience doesn't know. Back in the last couple of years of Vietnam, everybody that went overseas was chipped.
Oh wow.
Everybody.
Hmm.
And when we got into the Gulf, George Bush confirmed it.
Oh, wow.
You know, they were saying, aren't you worried about POWs? He said, we have means of tracking every one of our troops.
Wow.
All the time.
Wow.
So, we're, you know, if you're a vet, you're chipped. Now, what are they going to do with it? I don't know. You know?
Yeah. Basic GPS. And
then to show you how far advanced the military actually is, in the Battle of Khe Sanh, which is in 67, you know, the Marines were trapped on the top of the hill surrounded by the Viet Cong. They couldn't supply them, they couldn't do anything else. You know, they were worried that they're going to be overrun. So what the military did is they dropped all these sensors all around Khe Sanh.
Mm.
Right? They looked like those plugs that you use for termites that you put in the ground.
Oh, yeah.
The sensors could pick up vibration.
Wow.
They could pick up human urine.
Wow.
The chemicals, they could pick up all this stuff. All of the, think about it, this is 67.
Yeah.
They could pick up all this stuff and transmit that data to another location.
Wow.
So that the Army and of course, the Air Force was part, I think it was still part of the Army at the time. But anyway, the Army and the Air Force and the Marine Corps knew where the Viet Cong were so they could bomb them. But think of that technology.
Sure. Yep. Military is always like 20 years ahead.
1967.
Yeah.
When I was in, all these guys told me, you know, I worked with all the crypto guys and the, you know, the guys that did all this electronic warfare, and they tell me we're 30 years ahead of
right 30 years yeah yeah
that you see on the market.
Sure.
But if you go back to 67, who would have thought that we would have the computer technology to do this?
Right. Yep, exactly. It's crazy.
So Big Brother's already here. He knows. They even know probably how many squares of toilet paper you would wrap.
Right? Exactly. Square by square. I know. It's like, you know what? Got more important things in life to... It's like, but, you know.
Yeah. What are you going to do about it?
I know. Well, not live in fear. Live your life. You know, it's like, well, hey, you know what?
Well, I don't know. I'm getting kind of stressed out with all the stuff going on. And
yeah.
My big thing is I like consistency. If you tell me A, then you do A.
Right.
If you don't tell me A, you do B.
Sure.
You know, so I'm having a little difficulty.
Stick with your
with
A.
All of the stuff that is being said and done.
Sure.
What's the outcome?
Yep.
You know?
Right.
And shoot, when I was down in your area last time, Gary, I had people flipping me off because I didn't have my mask on in the car.
Oh, yeah. There's common sense stuff. There's common sense stuff. Sure.
Well,
yeah.
You know.
Yep. Sorry, that's your space. And
know, the thing is, if you're telling me I got to wear a mask, I will wear a mask.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't wear a mask if I'm outside by myself.
Getting fresh air. Yeah. Yeah.
And I don't wear a mask in my car.
Sure. Right.
So I do in the grocery store. So yeah.
Well, yeah. I think if anything, there's a good balance. That we've been talking about that, and you know, it is cold and flu season. Wash your hands. We're sick. It's just good stuff. Then just be a little extra careful, but not freaking out.
There was our state or our county health official, right? Mm-hmm. The guy runs the county of Sacramento. He just retired. We got a lot of people in the state, medical people that are retiring or moving on to other places, and I don't want to get political, but there's a political reason for that.
Gotcha.
But he was saying, you know, the amount of people that we have in the ICU and that are in other places are the same percentage of people that we would have in a normal year due to the flu.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah.
So, and you know, I'm not a doctor, although I've played one at different times in my life. But, you know,
right.
You know, the thing is that statistically, when you have these anomalies, you have to be able to say why did the anomaly cause.
Sure.
You know how many people have died of flu throughout the country?
Oh, sure.
Last year.
Yeah. Well, I don't have a percentage, but I know that it's lower, right, than right now.
It's almost non-existent because nobody reports it.
Oh, right, because it's all COVID.
You know, nobody, you know, and so... There's all these things. I know there's an agenda out there. You just don't want to think this is as sinister as you may think it is. They had a woman from a professor from Princeton pulled all the reports from CDC on deaths. And every year we have a certain percentage of people that die, whether that be car accidents, heart attacks, whatever. That percentage hasn't moved last year and this year.
Mm. Wow.
You say, with COVID, how could it not?
Right.
Because everything is being labeled COVID.
Sure. Yep.
So I don't know what the answer is. I mean, I just get anecdotal stories from people.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's like, I don't know.
Yeah.
There's too much stuff going on that doesn't make sense.
Sure. Yeah. And so I think asking questions is good.
The alien invasion thing is
it's got to be the answer. Okay. John, this is awesome. Good stuff. We're gonna go talk about, you know, family stuff real quicker. But thanks for being on our show. And hey, we're looking forward to good sci-fi out there, and hopefully not living it. But I guess we are.
The best thing about sci-fi is you can just let your mind wander.
Yeah, it's escape.
Thundar the Barbarian. The year 1994. From out of space comes a runaway planet, hurtling between the Earth and the Moon, unleashing cosmic destruction.
Yeah, the possibilities. I think they are too, so very good stuff. And so check out those shows. I know I definitely will. And I'm still Gary. Are you still John?
That's it.
As far as you know, all right. And class is dismissed. Thanks for listening to Necology 101, the study of nerd and geek in their natural habitat. If you like what you hear, hit that subscribe button and stay up to date with all that's new in the Phantom Universe.
You can find Ecology 101 on Spotify, YouTube, Podbean, or wherever you listen to podcasts. Love to hear from our fans, and your input helps make this show possible. Find us on Facebook and Instagram at Gotham and Geeks, or you can contact us at ecology101class@gmail.com. We know we have a lot of fandom choices out there, so thanks for letting us invade your fandom universe. Because we are still the knights who say, Meek.